Biodiversity was a word that was coined from the phrase biological diversity, refers to the variety of life on Earth at all of its levels, from genes to ecosystems, and can encompass the evolutionary, ecological, and cultural processes that sustain life. Plants, specifically, supply food to nearly all terrestrial organisms, including humans. We eat either plants or other organisms that eat plants. Plants maintain the atmosphere. They produce the oxygen we breathe. They regulate the compounds in the atmosphere. They protect us from UV radiation through the ozone layer, and they remove carbon dioxide which reduces the greenhouse effect and global warming. Plants also recycle matter in biogeochemical cycles. They move enormous amounts of water from the soil to the atmosphere, making rain. And plants directly provide many products that we use directly, such as medicines. Even nowadays, most of our medicines come indirectly or directly from plants. They also produce timber and fuel and fibers and so forth that we use. And they create the habitat and context for nearly all other organisms. So food sources for animals, insects, et cetera. So if we look at a map of global biodiversity, and in this case, focusing on plants, the bright red and pink and blue colors are where there's high biodiversity. When we look at global biodiversity, we see a striking pattern that plant biodiversity and most other groups of organisms as well are most diverse near the equator and less diverse as we go away from the equator in either direction. Tropical biodiversity is different than temperate, is different from boreal biodiversity. Different species occur in those different areas, so it's not a trade-off. And the southeastern United States is particularly rich in temperate biodiversity. If we look at, zoom into the United States and look at plant species diversity, we see the greens and blues of areas that have high diversity, mainly in eastern and particularly southeastern United States and also California. If we jump up to the genus level, we also see that the southeast is rich as well as the southwest and California. If we hop up another level to plant family diversity, the situation changes and we see that the southeast is where it's at. And why is that? It's because the southeast has been a resilient refuge for biodiversity and generator of biodiversity for tens of millions, even hundreds of millions of years. And that gives us real hope for the future that the Southeast can also hold on to biodiversity well going forward. But when we look at the Southeastern US, a lot of times we think of it as looking sort of like this, kind of forested and green and nice, but maybe a little bit boring. But we have to realize that the Southeast has a tremendous diversity of habitats, from rocky places to deep soils, from cold to hot, from wet to dry, from high pH soils to low pH soils, et cetera. So it is this kind of diversity of environmental factors that lead to a diversity of life. Elevation, which is a surrogate for temperature, we have sea level up to the highest elevations in eastern North America. So we have a climate transect across North Carolina. When we look at the geology of North Carolina, we essentially have all of the rock types present on Earth, all squeezed into the borders of North Carolina. So very high geologic diversity. And we have some climate diversity with the highest rainfall areas east of the Pacific Northwest, down in the southwest corner of North Carolina, Joyce Kilmer, Highlands, North Carolina area. And we also have a diversity of fire regimes that shape the vegetation and the natural communities of our region. So when we boil it all down and look specifically at North Carolina, North Carolina has really high plant biodiversity and a lot of narrowly distributed endemic species and threatened species. In this map, we see the hot oranges and pinks where there's very high endemism and imperiled species. And we can once again see that that is really concentrated in the southeast and the mountains, the Piedmont and the coastal plain, as well as some other parts of the country. And the richness of the coastal plain led Reed Noss, famous conservation biologist and colleagues in 2014 to designate the Southeastern Coastal Plain as a biodiversity hotspot, the 35th so designated in the world. And in its context, here are the other biodiversity hotspots. You can see that they are mostly located towards the equator or in warm temperate areas. The hotspot designation is kind of a good news, bad news situation. It designates areas that have really high and unique biodiversity, but that also have very high threats to the biodiversity that they have. Let's turn to the Southeastern Coastal Plain and focus on it a little bit. Land of the longleaf pine, why we are called the Tar Heel State, the predominant ecosystem that once covered most of the coastal plain of North Carolina was the longleaf pine ecosystem. It has now been heavily reduced, strongly reduced by the naval stores industry and conversion to agriculture, land conversion to agriculture, forestry, industrial forestry, cities, and so forth. So we don't see as much of this longleaf pine ecosystem as we once did. It's a highly imperiled ecosystem, and therefore all of the species that are in it are also highly imperiled. Now, one of the really special groups in the Southeastern United States, and specifically North Carolina, are carnivorous plants. And carnivory evolved because of the limitation in acid soils of a couple of nutrients, nitrogen and phosphorus. And those nutrients are heavily available in animal bodies. So plants evolved independently many times in various different plant groups in nutrient-poor parts of the world to develop in carnivory or insectivory. And they've also evolved a whole various set of different mechanisms, from snap traps like Venus flytrap to flypaper traps like butterwort and sundews with sticky substances that insects get caught by and then digested, to pitfall trap. You may be able to see the hairs in the pitcher plant all facing downward so that an insect, once it gets started down that tube, it's all downhill to death. Carnivory is one of the richest areas for it in the world is in the Southeastern United States. And we have three families of plants that are carnivorous, five genera and 40 species in the Southeastern US.